Vayan conectándose, gloria al Señor, en el nombre de Jesucristo de Nazaret. En breve estaremos comenzando, gloria al Señor, con esta transmisión especial. Gloria al Señor, que hoy nosotros vamos a hacer algo un poco distinto. Hoy vamos a predicar, gloria al Señor, este mensaje en inglés. Para todos aquellos, gloria al Señor, que pues nosotros tenemos aquí también que quisieran edificarse, gloria al Señor, con una prédica en inglés. Amén. Así que mi disculpa a aquellos que pues por mucho tiempo me han escuchado predicar y enseñar en español. Yo creo que por un día que me puedan ceder para yo poder también glorificar al Señor, amén, con la palabra en inglés, para aquellos de la audiencia y los amigos que nos siguen, que tenemos gente de India, de Pakistán, de África, personas que hablan inglés nada más, no hablan el español. Gloria al Señor, y queremos también que ellos se edifiquen. Gloria al Señor que vive, amén. God bless everyone here tonight. We're going to be preaching here this sermon in English for the benefit of those that we have here that actually follow us and that are actually from different parts of the world. We got people from India, Pakistan, Africa that actually follow us, and that there's times that they just don't, they don't understand much of the services that I do through Facebook because of the language barrier. And so tonight I'm going to do something special. I'm going to actually, for the sake of those that follow us and that listen to our messages, I'm going to preach this message in English. So for those that have been so accustomed to hear me preach in Spanish, I'm just asking you today, to just give me this chance. Let me just minister to those that that otherwise cannot be ministered or be edified because of the language barrier of, you know, only understanding English and vice versa. Okay, so just stay tuned, because we're coming today with the title, The Power of His Grace. There's something about the God's grace that actually liberates us. And not only liberates us in terms of our own a personhood or in our own infirmities, but it also liberates us from the power of sin, from the power of the law. And so it creates that freedom for you and I to be able to live according to the design, to the will, and the purpose of God. So stay tuned. Don't go away. We'll be right back. Glory be to God. God bless you. God bless everyone that is tuning in tonight. We have a special sermon for you. I bless everyone here tonight in the name of Jesus Christ. My name is Pastor Jesus Osorio, and I am the president of the International Ministry of Claela. It is a pleasure and a privilege to be able to minister to thousands of many of you that actually tune in on a daily basis. However, I am under the impression, and it is very possible, that today's audience may be smaller than usual simply because of the language barrier. However, In the name of Jesus and through the power of the Holy Spirit, I am expecting that God pours his blessing upon you, no matter who you are and no matter whether or not you understand what I am saying here tonight. I mean, we serve the God of many languages. He is the God of all tribes, of all nations, and so in all kindreds and tongues. And so I am believing God that he is going to deliver and translate this message, not so much in the language that you may understand, but rather in your spirit, that you may receive this, that you may embrace it, and that you may somehow be transformed through it. Because today we will be speaking about the power of his grace. And I am going to actually share with you 7 principles of his grace and why you need to actually receive this, and why you really need to actually acknowledge and understand why these principles will actually free you. It will change your mind. It will create a paradigm shift in your soul, in your spirit, because for so many years and throughout time and history, the church has been living in bondage. Even though that we have been freed, that we have been saved, even though through the works of the cross, the church still remains in this spiritual bondage, because we have failed to understand the power of his grace. And so with that, I want to go to the book of Titus. This is one of Paul's epistles. And let's go to chapter 2. And I'm going to start reading in verse 11 through 15. Okay, Titus chapter 2, verse 11 through 15. And it reads in such manner, in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit. It says, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age. Verse 13, it says, looking for the blessed hope. That is the rapture. He's speaking about that rapture. Looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. He continues in verse 14 saying, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and impurity for himself, his own special people, zealous for good works. And then verse 15, it says, speak these things, exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no one despise you. Amen. Glory be to Jesus. I love this epistle. It's one of those letters that Paul writes to edify the church. But most importantly, it's directed to a specific individual. And so here we see Paul speaking to Titus, letting him know that what grace truly is. It was this revelation, this secret revelation revealed. It was revealed to all men, as we see on verse 11. It says, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. We can see this in other translations, that instead of appeared, it uses the term revealed to all men, meaning that God's grace was not evident until the work of the cross. See, the people of Israel, and even those that are still under the law, for them, grace was unknown. It was unrevealed, because through the work of the cross, through the works and the sacrifice of Christ, it was only possible then to actually experience and see the work and the power of grace. So first of all, allow me to simplify the term or definition of what grace is. Grace is
that which God gives you and me without us deserving it. In other words, no matter who you are, no matter where you come from, I don't care if you have an affluent life. I don't care if you have money, if you are rich. It doesn't matter who you are, where you come from. It doesn't matter if you come from a royal family. It doesn't matter even if you have sacrificed all your life to be who you are. Nothing that you have is, you have it simply because you deserve it. You only have it because of God's grace. Our life is because of God's grace. Your family is because of God's grace. The ministry is because of God's grace. That employment that you have is because of God's grace. That house, that car, that bank account, everything that you have is because of God's grace. You may think that it's because of your own effort. You may believe that it's because of everything that you have sacrificed. That may be so. But you and I must understand that grace, when it comes to the gospel, Jesus, when it comes to God, it has nothing, absolutely nothing to do with your works, your efforts, your sacrifice. Grace, therefore, has a lot and everything to do with the work of the cross. And it simply reveals who God is. Even in the midst of sin, in the midst of chaos, in the midst of crisis, in the midst of violence, in the midst of everything that we are witnessing, God's grace is still upon us. And it is working, even though you and I don't see it. I constantly hear people always complaining about, why is this going this way? Why am I not seeing what I am asking for? Why is other people being blessed while I am still expecting my breakthrough? And we really allow the what we call unjust the injustice, we allow that to really blind us from the reality that even though you don't see your prayers answered, that even though you're not seeing your breakthrough, that even though you may not hear God speak to you, that even though things are not working out for you the way you expected, you still have to be able to see God's grace and His power working even through your life. Because otherwise we become ungrateful individuals. And so we have to be able, I believe that Paul is really speaking to the heart of Titus. I mean, this is if you go to chapter 1, you're going to realize that, you know, how he presents Titus. He says to Titus, a true son in our common faith. I mean, he identifies him not only as a true son, but he also makes a connection, him being a person and an individual with a common faith, a solid faith, a steadfast faith, a faith that has not been moved or somehow contaminated or tainted because of everything that was surrounding that church in those times. And so he is classifying it, and he wants to make sure that Titus understands that the beginning and the power of grace begins when it is introduced to all men. Because he says that it is God's grace that not only has been introduced to all men, but it brought with grace salvation. So we see that grace is accompanied by someone. Oh my God. Hallelujah. See, grace never presents to men by itself. Grace has company. And that company is salvation. It says God's grace brings salvation, has been revealed or appeared to all men. I love that. I love the fact that he doesn't leave no one out. This is not an exclusion statement. It's an all-inclusive one because it includes everyone. It says it's been revealed to all men, not to only a certain group, not to only a specific country, not to only a specific nation. No, it's been revealed to all men. Why? Why is it important? So that you and I, and no matter who it is, that you and I don't have an excuse. Because we have a lot of people that will eventually have the audacity to have an excuse before God. And I'm here to tell you right now, there's nothing that you can say right now or even in that time that can be worthy of an excuse for you to escape judgment or the wrath of God, because his word is plain that God's grace bringing salvation has been revealed and appeared to all men. And then he says, teaching us. You know, he explains how what grace does. It teaches us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust, to live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age. He continues to say that it helps us to look forward to the blessed hope. Because without grace, without God's grace, you and I will eventually live with no hope. There will be no expectancy in our lives. We will continue to actually express the same things we are continually to hear right now. What's the new norm now? We are hearing people teaching that there is no rapture, that there is no such thing. We got people demonized trying to distort the word and trying to rip us apart from the only thing that we have, which is called the blessed hope, the glorious return of our Lord and God Jesus Christ. And so when we realize and we really dive deeper in understanding God's grace, then we begin to live with power, with freedom. We begin to live the life that God expects us to live, and not what the people around us expects us to live. We have to understand that we live in a time that people expect too much. They expect probably more than enough. And when we don't live to their standards, then we become this faded image of Christ or Christians. And you need to understand that we need to go back to the Bible. We are solely relying so much on what people have to say about us that we begin to intertwine ourselves in becoming what people want us to be rather than becoming what God wants us to be and what he has actually designed us and ordained us to be. So here are the seven principles. I don't want to take too much time. Here are the seven principles of what you need to know of what the power of grace is all about. Okay, here, number one. You need to understand that God's grace cannot be earned. You cannot earn God's grace. There's nothing, like I said at the beginning, there's nothing that you and I could do. I don't care if you live this, that you believe you can live a perfect life. It doesn't matter, again, what you do, where you come from. I mean, you can do all kinds of things. Be this perfect citizen. Pay all your taxes. Never have trouble with the law. I mean, be this outstanding individual. Do all that. And that will still fall short. Because God's grace cannot be earned. It is unmerited. I mean, besides being one of God's attributes, it is really God's character. Grace is what he gives you, even though you don't deserve it. You don't have to beg for it. You don't have to try to convince God for it. You don't have to try to somehow sacrifice anything for it. You are given it, but because of who God is, not because of who you are. And so you need to understand that God's grace cannot be earned. It doesn't matter what you do. And so we have this notion that you can somehow do so much, jump so high, or work enough where you can actually earn God's grace. And that is not what the Bible teaches us. As a matter of fact, if we go to Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, it says, God saved you by grace when you believed. And you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation, therefore, is not a reward for the good things we have done, so none of us can boast about it. This idea that you can somehow boast because you what? Because you feed people? Because you go out in the streets and you hand bags of food and all of a sudden you have accumulated God's grace credit? I mean, somehow because you live godly or apparently live godly, to where everybody sees you that you are a godly man because of how you dress or how you pray or because how many days you fast, you believe now that you can earn God's grace? It doesn't work that way. And so in order for you to understand the power of grace, you need to understand that it is not something that you can earn. Because if it is something that you can earn, it has no power. Oh my God. It loses its power. It loses its influence. See, here's the thing. You can go to work and you put in hours. Hence, you can earn your wages. But you cannot earn God's grace because it is not something that you can work for, sweat enough, work hard enough, and then expect that you get paid God's grace. It doesn't work that way. God's grace is unmerited. He gives it to you whether you are good or bad. I mean, that is the awesomeness. And it has this majestic expression to it. The fact that we know that he gives us this grace to be saved, this grace to understand that it was given to us even though we didn't work for it. It was given to us even though we didn't beg for it. As a matter of fact, God's grace is so undeserving that even before you came to believe in God, his grace was already being poured upon you. That's how powerful it is. That's how special his grace is. But it cannot be one that you think that you can deserve. You cannot accumulate enough points to earn God's grace. You cannot be good enough and perfect enough to earn God's grace. It doesn't matter whether or not you have been an excellent role model in life. I mean, of course, who doesn't want a good role model? Who doesn't want to admire someone that they see making progress or changes or whatnot? But nothing that we can do or be can earn us this grace. For his grace is unmerited. And quite frankly, too many Christians, especially when we speak about in the legal sense, many Christians are still bound under the belief that if they obey enough, if they read the Bible enough, if they pray long enough, if they fast certain days enough or certain hours enough, that will actually give them more access to God's grace. And that is a false notion. As a matter of fact, it actually is a satanic type of thinking. Because if you think that you can somehow work hard enough to earn God's grace, you have fallen from grace. Because the true sense of grace is that you do not think that you can do something so that you can come back and boast about it. We have too many people boasting about who they are and what they do. Those individuals have already fallen from grace. Can I get an amen? Those people that have thought that because they have a huge ministry, that because they have all these photos and videos of them delivering food, if you have thought that that has gained you enough grace, then my friend, my brother, you have already fallen from grace. Because this type of grace is unmerited. Nothing you can do to earn this type of grace. Number two, the power of God's grace lets us know this, that there is no such thing as a perfect Christian. The power of God's grace, number two, lets us know that there is no such thing as a perfect Christian. The sooner you understand that and the sooner you realize that, the less heartache you will have. The less stressful you will become. Because once again, we live in a world with high expectation. People expect too much of us, Christians especially. They expect us to behave well. They expect us to speak in a certain manner. They expect us to exhibit certain virtues and to behave in a certain manner. Of course. I mean, we see it here in verse 12, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, and we should live soberly and righteously and godly in the present age. I get it. I get it. We're supposed to be light in darkness. We're supposed to be the salt of this earth. I get it. I understand that. But the world still expects too much of us. And in saying that, I mean, they expect us to be so perfect that to demonstrate or to manifest a flaw, it actually allows them to crumble the whole essence of the gospel. And so if you falter, if you do something that is out of norm, that it is out of character for a Christian, then all of a sudden you become the center stage for being blasphemed, for being judged, for being criticized. Because regardless of who we are to be, it doesn't mean that we stop being human. In this human nature, in this fallen state of human nature, in this body, in this flesh, we will still fall short. We will never be too enough or great enough for certain people. It doesn't matter who and you and I are. Doesn't matter what you say. Doesn't matter what you do. For a lot of people, it will never be enough. You will never meet their standards. You will never fulfill their expectations. And so, God's grace allows us to understand that we are not perfect. Now, does not being perfect means that it gives us access to sin? No, it doesn't. It doesn't mean that. It doesn't mean that it gives us access or a license to act like fools, because many of us are. But what I'm saying is that when we understand God's grace and how it somehow manifests this power, it allows us to realize that we're not perfect and that God loves us just as we are. Look at Romans 3, verse 23. It says, for all, not some. It doesn't say some. It says, for all have sinned and fallen short for the glory of God. It says all. It doesn't say some. It says, for all have sinned and have fallen short from the glory of God. Now, I dare any pastor, any apostle, any teacher, any evangelist, any brother to actually tell me that we are so perfect that we don't sin at times, that we don't make poor choices, that we don't disobey God's word or his will. I dare anyone challenge me on that. We all do it. We all disobey God. We all fall short from his glory. We all miss. Listen, the simple fact that you misinterpret and teach God's word erroneously, you have already disobeyed his commandment. You have already fallen short. You have already fallen from grace. Because we expect so much of us ourselves at times because of what others expect from us. And we got to stop living in people's shadows. We got to start living in God's shadow. We got to start focusing on what God wants us and you and me to be. You need to understand that there is no such thing as a perfect Christian. We are all going to somehow tick somebody off. We're going to have a lot of people that don't like us. And believe me, I have plenty of people here that really don't like me. They will literally be able to lynch me if they had the opportunity. I get it. I understand that. I'm not a $100 bill that everybody gets along with me. I get it. I understand that. To some people, I mean, it may be even fun for them. It may be even become natural of their nature to actually hate and despise people. I get it. I understand that. That allows God's grace allows me then to focus on the fact that even though I'm not perfect, I know that whatever work God has started and commenced in me, he will actually complete it until the end. It makes me understand that and appreciate the fact that God has not finished with me. He has not finished with you either. So you need to know that God's grace and his power is so overwhelming that when we begin to embrace that grace, you're going to realize that God loves you the way you are. He loves you with all your history and all your past. That he's not like men do. That men like to criticize and judge and do all kinds of things to bring up the past. But God doesn't do that. God loves you just like you who you are. But you need to know that it is because of his grace that you're able to auto-examine yourself. That you are able to do this self-exam of your own self or your inner being. That if anything, the only thing that is perfect in essence is your spirit. Because that is where the spirit, the Holy Spirit dwells. And the Holy Spirit begins to transform us. Transform the way we think, the way we speak, the way we act, the way we feel. Everything begins to change. But it is a work in progress. It is a progressive process. And you can't forget that. You must see yourself in the mirror of the word and not in the mirror of the people and of what people expect from you. Number three, the power of God's grace is that Christ died so that you and I could live. I mean, this is awesome because here we see the awesome exchange of position. And with that awesome exchange of position, we see that Christ takes your place of condemnation and we take his place of being saved, of God's grace and mercy. We are then justified because of that. And so grace allows us to really study the work of the cross. Many people may think, what is this whole thing of the sacrifice of the cross about? What is it really about? I mean, many people have heard about the story of the sacrificial love of Christ and how he gave his life for humanity. But in reality, have you really thought about the work of the cross? Why? I mean, what was really being demonstrated when Christ was being hung by that cross, shedding all that blood, being hated, being blasphemed, being mocked. What was really the story behind that? Besides love and mercy, it was grace. God's grace was being poured on humanity because of Christ's death, because of Christ's persecution and crucifixion. It was because of that we were able to live. Aside from that, you or I was still dead in our sins. When we look at God's grace, we see that there's the power of liberation. It is because of that grace and because of Christ dying through the works of the cross that now we are able to live and that we are able to see our purpose and destiny in this life. Prior to that, you did not know why you were born and where you came from. You did not know what was your purpose here on earth, and you did not even know or realize where you end up after death. But because of Christ dying on the cross, and because he died for us, for you and I, those questions were answered. Now you and I know why we were born. Now you and I can answer the question of why we were placed on this earth. Now we can answer the question that if I die, glory to God, we know where we will be. And that it was with Christ. Because he died and rose from the dead, we know that we can also have that victory. Look at Galatians chapter 2 verse 21. It says, I do not treat the grace of God as meaningless. For if keeping the law could make us right with God, then there was no need for Christ to die. Oh my God. You got to listen to that. I mean, it is clear of what he's saying. He said, we cannot treat God's grace as meaningless or take his grace for granted. He said, for if keeping the law could have made us right with God, then Christ's dying was not suffice. Christ dying was meaningless. Christ dying was unnecessary. Because the law would have been suffice. The law would have had the power to make us righteous with God. But it wasn't. It wasn't. The law was made to bring condemnation to us. Because seeing the law, as we look at ourselves through a mirror, it allowed us to see all the imperfections and the impurities and the sinfulness. So when we look at the law, we're looking at ourselves, we're looking at the imperfection, we're looking at all the sin, we're looking at the condemnation, we're looking at a darkened and a lost soul, headed and destitute for condemnation and death, eternal death. But when Christ died, he liberated us from that. See, the law demanded justice. It demanded persecution. It demanded to be prosecuted and sentenced. The sentence from the law demands death. It's only one sentence. It's death. But Christ came to pay for that. This is why this is so essential. It's so crucial that we do not misunderstand what the power of grace is. If we miss it, we miss the whole gospel. We miss the whole sense of the word. We miss the whole sense of God's purpose and will. We miss the whole work of the cross. It is because Christ died. It is because you and I have life. Eternal life, for that matter. And so that in itself should be enough for us to glorify God. It should be enough for us to actually praise him and want really to get to know God and come close to him and understand that without God, nothing is impossible. That we need to know that with him, with God, everything would be possible, that with God we can live a free life, that with God we will be able to do whatever He wants us to do and not what we pretend to do. Number four, the power of God's grace lets us know that we should not take advantage of that grace, as I mentioned a few seconds ago. That we should not take advantage because this is, this, see, God's grace is not a thank you note. It is not a type of employee merit or increased merit. A lot of us receive increased merits at work. This is not a God's grace is not an interview with you to see how good you've been and to determine whether or not you can receive a merit of grace. It doesn't work that way. That's not what this is. And so we must understand that God's grace is so powerful that we must be very careful, which is the fourth point, to not take that grace for granted. And a lot of us do it. Look at Romans chapter 6, verse 15. It says, well then, since God's grace has set us free from the law, does that mean that we can go on sinning? Of course not. He does that with great exclamation. Of course not. It doesn't mean that it gives you a license to go out and sin. It doesn't mean that it gives us permission to live this crazy life. La vida loca. It doesn't mean that. And I'm afraid that we have this doctrine of once saved, always saved, which teaches really that once you are saved and once you are sealed by God's Holy Spirit, that no matter what you do from there on, you can't lose that salvation. And that is a demonic doctrine, because what it does, it makes us so complacent with the worldly view. It makes us so in tune with what we're seeing today. Everything that we're seeing in the world is so against God's word. Gay marriages, abortion, suicides, you know, everything that we see now and day playing out, it goes against God's scripture, God's will, God's purpose, God's design. And we applaud that. The church is applauding that. The church is embracing that. And what we are doing really is we're taking God's grace for granted. For God is love, but He is also a consuming fire. And I don't get how people miss that, the simplicity of that. He loves us. Yes, absolutely. He forgives us all the time. But we got to be careful with God's grace, because God's grace, again, is something that He gives you without you deserving it. There was nothing that you did. There was nothing that you could do. It doesn't matter if you begged enough. It doesn't matter if you prayed long, long, long hours. It doesn't matter. Grace is unmerited. It's undeserving. There's nothing that you and I can do. But we got to be careful, because it is undeserving and unmerited, and it comes because of God's love and His character, we have to be careful that we think or we assume that because of that grace, we can live the type of life that we think that we can live, and that we can live ungodly lives, that we can do whatever we want, and that we can go against God's word. We have to be cautious, because He will chastise us. He does discipline. I remember hearing a sister years ago when I was at a church, and I was teaching about God's discipline through Hebrews chapter 12. And I remember she had this frown face throughout the whole study. And then at the end of the Bible study, she approached me and she said, "Pastor, you know, I know you taught about, you know, how God, you know, he disciplines His children and not, but I don't think He does." I was baffled, because it's the word. The word says that God chastises or disciplines those He loves. It's there. It's in the Bible. It was not an opinion. It was not a personal statement. And I was kind of baffled at the fact that she refused to believe that God will still discipline or chastise his children. And I immediately, I mean, like lightning, I felt like the Holy Spirit telling me, ask her if she has children. Of course, I knew she had, but I just wanted to establish the platform of what I was about to ask. And so she said, yeah, I have children. Okay. And I said, have you ever disciplined your children whenever they misbehaved or whenever they gave you got bad report from school? Did you ever discipline them? And at that moment, she looked at me and she said, I see where you're coming from. Yes. So does God. I mean, he will discipline us. He will chastise us. But why? Because he loves us. Because otherwise, the Bible, that same chapter in Hebrews, it says, because if he doesn't chastise us, it would be like if we were bastards. And the word bastard means children without a father. And so we have to be careful to not take God's grace for granted. Because his power, his love, his grace, his authority is still in effect. And he will use it under those who take his grace for granted. Again, it is grace, unmerited grace, undeserving. But it doesn't mean that you and I could live our life as we wish. We must still be godly. We must still, in the face of adversity, in the face of a sinful world, with all these worldly views, we still must live as light in this world and salt of this earth. We must still live by example. Number five, the power of God's grace is that, once again, the only source of grace is God himself. Again, the power of God's grace is so much that he is the only source of that grace. That means that you don't have to look for any other source to receive that grace. You can't get this grace by your neighbors. You can't get this grace by your mother and father. You don't get this grace by your husband or wife. You don't get this grace by your children. You don't get this grace by your employees or employer. No, there is no other source for this grace other than God. Only God gives and is the only source of this grace. That is the awesome power of the grace. Because imagine if you could find another source of that grace, it loses its power. It has no authority. And so what brings comfort to me is knowing that there is only one source where that grace comes from, and that is through God. He is the only source of that grace. Psalms 84, verse 11, it says, for the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly. See, he's not going to withhold anything. He wants to give you grace. He wants to love you. He wants to forgive you. He wants to somehow empower you and I. That's his purpose. That's his will. That's what makes him joyful, if you will. That's what pleases him, is to see you become who he wants you to be. He wants you to have success. He wants you to live with victory. He wants you to overpower and overthrow everything that is against his word and his kingdom. He wants you to have power over principalities. He wants you to have power over Satan's traps and everything that he throws at us. He wants you to live with power and authority. But you need to know that his grace, the grace that you and I receive, it only has one source, and that is God. You can't get it from anybody else. And so this really, really kind of establishes the belief that his grace is all sufficient. Because of the matter that it comes directly from God, It allows me to say, this grace is all sufficient. This grace is all perfect. This grace right now is all that I need. And because of that grace, we can worship him. Because of that grace that comes directly from him, we are able to really appraise him. And we're able to sing hymns. We're able to preach with passion. We're able to call upon his presence and the Holy Spirit. Because of that, it is only because of that. And it really allows us to see God in a different perspective. We see his glory in how he works through us and for us and through others. And so you got to remember that God's grace only has one source. It's through him. It nothing else. Number six, God's grace is sufficient. You don't need nothing else. God's grace is so powerful that it is the only thing that you will require. It is the only thing that you need. It is the only thing that you must approve of. You don't need anything else. You don't need God, people's approval. You don't need to live to other people's standards. All you need is God's grace. That unmerited favor. That unmerited and gifted grace. Because he loves you just the way you are. It's all sufficient. It is enough. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. It says, and this is Paul speaking about that thorn in the flesh. You remember that story. Three times he asked the Lord to remove that thorn. And this is what he said. And he said to me, my grace is sufficient to you. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. Glory to God. Hallelujah. You see, even when we are battling with situations, with sin, with weaknesses, God allows us to experience that sufficient grace. And it somehow allows us to just realize that this is what God wants me to experience. Now, some of you may really connect to this because, you know, if you are eventually like me, and I know you are, in the sense of experience with God, then you will understand that there have been certain times in your life where you have asked God for something, and God has not responded. God has not, just simply said yes to a specific petition that you have. And there may be have time that you have approached God in prayer and you said, God, why have you not given me this? Why have you not allowed me to have, whatever it is? It may be sickness. There's someone right now that's listening to this that you have said, you have asked God to heal you. And he has not. Not because he wants you to suffer. Not because he's powerless. But because, just like Paul, he wants you to experience more his grace because it is sufficient. It is enough. Because sometimes we are so in tune and we are so focused more on the problem, on the situation, that we forget to experience his love, his grace, his mercy. And sometimes also because he wants us to learn to live and to be grateful in all things. Listen, there's people that only know how to be grateful, how to say thank you when everything is well. If God were to say yes to every petition, to every prayer that we ask of him, we will never learn how to live with his sufficient grace. Imagine if God said yes to every prayer. Imagine if God said yes to every petition that you have before him. Could you truly, could you honestly say that you have learned to appreciate, that you have learned to worship, that you have learned to somehow understand who God is? No. The reality is no, because you have not been tested. You have not known what it's like to even praise God in the midst of the storm. And so you and I need to know that the power of God's grace is really manifested when you appreciate that it is sufficient and that it is all you need. So you have this sickness, okay. God hasn't healed you yet, praise Him. Let Him know that your grace is all sufficient. Let Him know that even though you are dealing with the situation, that you're going to still praise Him and you're going to still worship Him, and that you are still going to seek Him with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul. Let Him know that your grace, that His grace is sufficient, that His grace allows you to live the abundant life, and that nothing or no one is going to disconnect you from that. And lastly, the power of God's grace lets us know also that it is because of Christ living now that grace continues to be manifested. Because Christ is now seated at the right side of the Father, He is still interceding for you and me. He is still praying. He is still acting as the mediator between man and God. Because of that, God's grace continues to still flow through Jesus Christ. John chapter 1 verse 14, it says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." You see, when we look at Christ, we're looking at the full grace and truth. And that grace is being transmitted, transported, and translated into your life through the awesomeness and the awesome person of Christ, the awesome attributes of Christ, and the awesome character of Christ. Everything that Christ was, is, and will be for all eternity is the revealing grace and His power for all of us. It is because of Jesus Christ, who is still present in the sense of the Holy Spirit now. It is because of that we're able to experience the awesome power of grace, the awesome power of God, His awesome forgiveness, His love, His everything. It is because of that. But without it, we have lost. Without this power of grace, without the experience of the grace that God gives us, we lose purpose. We lose focus. We won't be able to eloquently express who we are in God's eyes, in God's point of view. People who lose grace and who lose the essence of what it means constantly have to prove themselves to people. Because like I said, people are so brutal. People expect too much. And sometimes with great proportions. And when you don't meet those expectations, then you become less than nothing. You become that less essence of what a true Christian should be. And then you lose sight of everything. But God is telling us right now that His power in His grace has the ability to transform you, to equip you, has the ability to establish you, to ordain you, has the ability to actually declare you. It has the ability to prophesy in your life because His grace does all those things. But we need to actually come back to the Bible to realize how awesome and how great is His grace. God bless you. Thank you, each and every one of you. For those of you who have been tuned in, I thank you. And I bless you in Jesus' name. Thank you so much for taking aside of your time. If you've been blessed by this message, I encourage you to share it with others. Let others know the awesomeness of God's grace and why we should be very cautious to not live under the law. The law removes us from that experience of grace. But living under God's grace fully allows us to live with great success and with great victory. God bless you, and I hope you've been edified through God's word today. Thank you so much. God bless you, and we'll see you next time. Thank you so much.